Okay, so we were in the middle of talking about Stoltz's integrals yesterday, on Monday, and I think that we got as far as, saying everything that I intended to say to construct. So let's just very, very quickly go over this. So M is, I guess I said increasing last time, but I should have said non-decreasing, doesn't matter. And I think the thing that I made unclear last time, there was this normalization condition about making the function M continuous from the left, or lower semi-continuous, which is the same thing. And in fact, that is completely irrelevant for actually constructing the Stoltz's integral. It's relevant in a moment when we say that this is a classification of all the n integrals on M. And so the point was this, if f is compactly supported, continuous, well, that's, you can just, so vanishing outside of here, sorry, that's bad notation. It's just a function on R, the supported f happens to sit inside AB. Then we define for some n, we had lambda some partition. We defined this upper star sum of f, this sum of supremums of values of f over intervals of the partition times the value of this function m at the end of that partition point minus its value at the beginning of that interval of the partition. And similarly, which is exactly the same, you put an inf there. And then the point was that this is decreasing as lambda gets finer. Similarly, this number is increasing as the partition lambda gets finer. So we've got these increasing sequences. Well, I guess they're nets indexed by the partitions. But anyway, this increasing thing and this decreasing thing and this increasing thing. Certainly, it's obvious that this is bigger than that because it's just got a super and an inf. And so as long as we can show that they get arbitrarily close to each other, then they're both actually converging to some number. And the point was that uniform continuity. Uniform continuity. Guarantees these get arbitrarily close. I don't think I'm not gonna say exactly that argument again, but then so what we've got is these guys decreasing downwards to this number that we define to be the integral of f, and similarly these guys are decreasing upwards. We actually get some particular number in between, and the things you need to check, neither of which are hard, is that this is positive. But of course, if you know the function is positive, then this lower bound, even with the infimums in it, is still positive. So you've got some non-negative numbers converging up to it. So that part's easy. And slightly harder is that this is linear. But not particularly hard. Okay, so we then just want to see how you go back the other way. So if I've just got some arbitrary Radon integral, how can I see that it is of this form? So now let's fix some Radon integral on R. And let's just define M by the formula that m of x, well, sorry, wrong symbol. This is either going to be the integral, with respect to that we had an integral of the characteristic function from 0 up to x, if x is positive, and the integral with a minus sign of the integral from x up to 0, if x is negative. Okay, so the way that we've defined this, in fact, m is continuous from the left, so, well, so maybe we should have first said it's easy to see m is monotone, just because as x increases we're integrating bigger things, and x is continuous from the left, and for that you have to use the monotone convergence theorem. X, these characteristic functions increasing pointwise up to the characteristic function corresponding to the value of x you're converging to. So m is, well, you could, that's the same as saying it's lower semi-continuous. So the point here was that even though defining the Stoltz integral just worked for anything, and we didn't care about when it had these discontinuities, what the value of the function was at the discontinuity, what you can see is actually that the thing we define via this scheme actually doesn't care about the value of m at these discontinuities. You get the same integral if its value is there or there or there. Okay. So what we're going to do is when we go in the reverse direction and extract this function f, we're always going to construct ones that look like this, that are continuous from the left. And so the bijection that we're going to get is a bijection between monotone, non-decreasing, continuous from the left functions, and radon integrals. This part we didn't really care about that continuity condition, but the way that we're building our function m from the integral just produces lower semi-continuous ones, so that's why we set it up that way. Okay, so we need to show that the integral we started with is the Stoltz integral defined in terms of this function m that we just extracted from our integral. Okay, we're trying to see that this really is a bijection between the two things. Okay, so you've certainly got that if you take some arbitrary function here, in the domain of these guys, so some compactly supported function, then this is certainly less than the function where you look at the supremum over one of these intervals in a partition. Times the characteristic function of that interval of the partition. There's a mistake in the notes there. Okay, so now you can just integrate that. Everything here is integrable. This is just a compactly supported continuous function. That's completely fine. And then these are characteristic functions of finite intervals. So, well, they're integrable as well. Okay. So we just get this. It's just a finite sum, so we can happily integrate on the inside. This is just some constant, so that we can happily just pull that out. Same interval. And now we just need to integrate this. But by definition of m, that's exactly just m at lambda k plus 1 minus m at lambda k. Okay? That's how we defined it, basically, so that the integral of that would be that. Okay, and that of course was just one of these upper sums as we defined it just there for that partition. Okay, similarly, we've got the integral of f is bigger than the lower sum for whatever partition we use. But of course, these numbers here are converging down to integral sub n. Okay, so this guy is squeezed in between, and we see that the terrible integral symbol, the integral of f, is actually just the integral with respect to the Sturges integral for that. Okay, so it's not. So hard. Let me just write one or two. We will come back and need to use Stokes integrals later when we study spectral theory. So I just want to write a few exercises to have you guys think about how these work a little. So if it's absolutely continuous. Do you guys know what absolutely continuous means? Okay, we better let's set an aside on what absolute continuity is. Was it really not in the when you prove you presumably proved some version of the fundamental theorem of calculus in analysis 1 and or 2, and it didn't mention absolute. It did. It did mention absolute continuity. Okay, so you have seen it. I just need to remind you. Okay, let's just. So does anyone remember what the definition is? F absolutely continuous means, well, for all epsilon, there exists a delta, but it's not the usual where there's just now for any two pair, for any pair of points that are at most delta apart, the function values are at most epsilon apart. We then get to say, for all, how do I want to say it? For all, let's write it. A1 less than B1 less than A2 less than B2 less than up to less than AN less than BN. And I want to think of these as a whole bunch of disjoint intervals, the interval from A1 to B1, the interval from A2 to B2, the interval from AN to BN. The sum such that the sum of BI minus AI is less than delta. So if you have got a whole collection of intervals, but whose total length is at most delta, okay, then the sum of the differences of the function values across those intervals is less than epsilon. So it's like a version of continuity, but where instead of looking at how the function varies across a single interval, you're allowed to look at how it varies across a whole bunch of intervals simultaneously, as long as those intervals aren't too long in total. Then the total jump across those intervals will not be too big. And so the big point of absolute continuity is that that its derivative exists and is integrable and its integral is f again, so that's the usual setup of the fundamental theorem of calculus. I've mixed up my letters, e's and f's and so on. Okay. If you do the Stokes integral with respect to, and let's say monotone as well. So you can do a Stokes integral with respect to that f of some characteristic function. That's the same thing as just integrating over that interval this derivative. And here that's just with respect to the Lebesgue measure there. So if the functions that you're doing the Stokes construction with are nice in this sense, then actually these are sort of integrals that you've seen before, maybe, and let's say more generally, the integral, the Stokes integral for this f of some function is just the integral over R with respect to Lebesgue measure of f of x, f prime of x dx. Okay? So this is a sort of integral that we've known about for a long time. I mean, it's sort of, but the thing that Schiltje's integrals do beyond this is it lets you disregard this condition and have f prime have discontinuities and so on as well. And this left-hand side still makes sense in that case. So another good exercise to understand how this goes is if m is just the function the step function that goes from 0 up to 1, say at x equals 0, you can ask what is the Schiltje's integral there. Does anyone have a guess what that one is? Yeah, this is actually just evaluating the function at the point zero. Okay, if you think about, remember, like those upper and lower sums that defined that were converging to the Schiltje's integral. Basically, this is saying that, well, if your lambda k plus 1 and lambda k are both on the same side of 0, then you just get nothing in that term, because the values at m there are just the same, and that terms all just cancel out. And so all that you ever see is contributions to this where lambda k and lambda k plus 1 are on either side of this discontinuity. Then this term is just equal to 1, and all you see is the supremum of the function value over that that little interval you're looking at. But now we're taking the limits as the intervals are getting smaller, and so you can see that the limit of a supremum over an interval as the interval gets smaller is just the function value at the point that the interval is shrinking to. So in some sense, Schiltje's integrals are just a combination of these two ideas. We know our functions m are, well, I guess we don't quite know that, but they've got discontinuities and they've got other continuous regions. At least if they're absolutely continuous, then the Schiltje's integral is just behaving just like this. And at the places where there are discontinuities, it's just acting like this. It's a sort of point mass measure at the point where there's the jump with mass given by how big the jump is. Maybe another good one. Sorry, these exercises are in the notes now. You can show that if you look at the corresponding measure that you get out from the Schiltje's integral from a function m, you can show that the measure of a singleton point is zero if and only if m is continuous at x. That is, in places where your function m defining the Schiltje's integral is continuous, there's no point masses, I guess it was meant to be increasing, there's no point masses where the function is continuous, but there are point masses exactly where there are jumps. Well, good. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is a little bit ridiculous and go back essentially to where we abandoned the existing notes, which was in section 8 of the existing notes. And I'm going to just quickly state the results in those sections so that you're not completely at sea if someone talks to you about the basic ideas there. But we're just not going to prove anything from that section. But the point of this section, so it's essentially, so this is again section 8 from the notes, and it's really about the Cara-Teodori extinction theorem. Which is, you should think of it just as another way of constructing measures. So we've just spent God knows how long talking about how if you can build a Radon integral, that is a recipe for integrating compactly subordered continuous functions, then you can extract from that a measure. And here's another way of producing measures. And it's the pedestrian, old-fashioned way that everyone usually actually does it. Okay. So we're going to define a few things that aren't as good as measures. but nevertheless turn out to let you build measures. So an exterior measure on X is a function that we'll, I guess we'll write mu star from arbitrary subsets of X into zero up to and including infinity. So, well, such that the empty set has zero measure, it's increasing, so E is a subset of F, so mu star, of E is less than or equal to mu star of F, and it's countably subadditive. Star of a countable union of just arbitrary sets is bounded by the sum of the mu stars of these sets. Okay, so we're going to now state at least the extinction theorem, but I sort of want to warn you as we stated that it's a completely useless theorem as it stand, as it's going to stand at first, because it's pretty. It seems. I mean, it's hard to produce these exterior measures because you really need to specify what you mean by the size of absolutely every single set, and in practice, we're only ever going to do that by using the next idea that follows this thing, this business called pre-measures, which will actually be useful. So it's okay if you feel a little bit skeptical as we state the first version of the theorem. Okay, so let's have another definition. Set E in X is measurable with respect to mu star, some exterior measure, if for every other set A in X, the measure of that other set can be written as the measure of A intersect E plus the measure of A takeaway. Okay, so this is kind of crazy. So let's see what's going on here. A is certainly just the union of A intersect E and A takeaway E. So being countably subadditive tells us we've got a less than or equal to here. Okay, and so we're picking out the sets E as being measurable if they have this amazing property that whenever you take an arbitrary set and cut it up into the two pieces by E, you actually get additivity rather than subadditivity. Okay, so that's some condition saying that this set E is very special. But keeping track of that definition in your head, I always find it a bit hard. I find that definition extremely unintuitive. Okay, so here's the theorem, whose proof is in the notes, but we're just going to skip entirely. So the measurable sets form a sigma algebra. So this crazy quantity, this crazy property of E is preserved under complements, that's actually pretty easy, and under countable unions. And even though the proof in the notes is not written that way, if you remember when we talked about sigma algebras at first a few weeks ago, I told you this induction principle for sigma algebras, like if you want to prove some property holds for a sigma algebra, you check the following things. You should try and read the proof in the notes sort of through the lens of that induction principle. I think it becomes a bit easier to follow. Okay, the measurable sets form a sigma algebra, and mu star restricted to those sets is an honest measure that is actually countably additive on the sets E that satisfy this property for every other set A. Okay. So that feels like it's great. It's a way of producing sumo algebras and measures on them. The problem is we've got, it might be hard to construct these exterior measures, and this gives you no guarantees about what this sigma algebra is actually like. Okay, just as there's some sigma algebra, but it's a bit hard to tell what sets might be measurable. So the theorem that makes this construction viable is the following. So if X is a metric space, and mu star is what's known as a metric exterior measure, so this is now is defining metric exterior measure. If you've got two sets that are actually separated, so the distance between them is positive, then mu star of A union B should be equal to mu star of A plus mu star. So this is a condition on an exterior measure, guaranteeing you don't just have an inequality here, but if the sets are actually separated, then you get an equality. Then, so that was really just a definition of a metric exterior measure. The conclusion is that all the real sets in X are measurable with respect to mu star. And so let's just say, so the measure from the previous theorem is a Borel measure. We still don't know that much about what the sigma algebra is we get from that metric exterior measure, but we know it at least includes all the Borel sets, so we go home happy at that point and decide not to care too much about what else it thinks is measurable. Okay, then, now let's get to the useful part of this theory. This idea of pre-measures, which you can actually define and construct in a useful way. So a pre-measure, this time it's not something defined on all sets, but on some Boolean algebra M consisting of subsets of X, is function from the Boolean algebra to zero up to possibly including infinity. So let's call it mu zero. Again, mu zero of the empty set should be zero. And now we have a bit of a strange statement here. If EI is a countable collection of sets in M, and the union of the EIs happens to be in M2, okay? M here is only a Boolean algebra, so there's no reason why countable unions should still be in there. But if you happen to have that situation where you've got a bunch of things in M and their countable union turns out to be in M2, then you have additivity. Actual additivity, mu naught. Oh, sorry, it's a countable collection. I better say of disjoint sets so this doesn't work. Then this pre-measure of the EIs has to be actually equal to the sum, the pre-measures of the EIs. Okay, so that's fine. To construct a pre-measure now, in some ways, life is sort of not that bad, because you only have to define the values of the pre-measure on some Boolean algebra, which will typically be a some much more manageable thing. Like, remember when we talked about those inductive descriptions of Boolean algebras, and rather than the non-existence of inductive descriptions of sigma algebras. Well, anyway, so anyway, hopefully defining the function might not be so bad, but you do have this bit slightly strange condition you need to check to do things with the premeasure. Okay, and then here's the theorem that is the punchline of this section. So from a premeasure, we can construct an exterior measure. The way you do this is you say that mu star of some set, remember mu star we've got to define on absolutely every single set, so this is just the infimum over ways to write u as a subset of countably many EIs, with each of the EIs in the Boolean algebra of the sum of the premeasures of those EIs. So you should think here that you've got some crazy set that's our E, and then we're just thinking about ways of covering it, possibly with overlapping bits, by nice sets from our actual Boolean algebra, and then just taking the infimum as sort of these EIs shrink down, still covering. Okay, so not only does this formula define a premeasure, we can actually explicitly say what the measurable sets are. The mu star measurable sets contain M, and indeed contain the whole sigma algebra generated by M. Of course, just because the mu star measurable sets, as we talked about before, are a sigma algebra, so if you contain all of the things in M, you contain that whole sigma algebra generated by M. Okay, so let's just very briefly think about how this relates to what you guys did before. The claim is that this is actually what you're using when you constructed Lebesgue measure on R or on Rn or so on. Say we're working in Rn, you make a Boolean algebra that is just generated by all of the boxes in Rn, okay? So finite unions of boxes in Rn form a Boolean algebra. Okay, you can take finite unions and finite intersections and so on. And if I union those two guys together, obviously I have to cut this guy up again to rewrite it as a union of boxes, but you can do that. And then you define this premeasure just by saying that the premeasure of some union of boxes is just the sum of base times height, a thing you could teach to someone in kindergarten, and then you have to actually check that condition. So if you've got some box written as a union of boxes, then really the base time height formulas actually work out there, and so that's checking that condition. And then we build the Lebesgue measure basically by the two steps that are implicit in this theorem. Define the exterior measure mu star first, and then the Lebesgue measurable sets were actually the measurable sets with respect to that exterior measure. Okay. But you can see, like, from this example, that sort of the data you have to actually specify is often quite small to set up a pre-measure on a Boolean algebra. Just the boxes and base times height, and then these theorems give you everything else for free. Okay. The proofs of these that are in the notes follow pretty closely the proofs that are in Stein and Shikaki. If anyone is attempting to read them and being unhappy about them, there are slightly different proofs of those same theorems in Terry Tao's book, which I think are better than either what's in the notes or what's in Stein and Shikaki. So you might find a copy of that if you don't like the proof in the notes, and you try and read those. Okay, let's get on to something. Whatever comes next. Our next goal is to talk about product measures and to prove a general version of Fibini-Tonelli for nearly any abstract measure space. And we really have a choice here about which way to go, because we could decide to either set up this whole theory using measure theory, or we could set up this whole theory using integration theory with radon integrals instead of with measures. And I think in the interests of sanity and making sure that we actually see some conventional measure theory, I'm going to just do this following the notes, so following what's in section, I think it's 9, or maybe one of the sections of the notes. We'll follow reasonably closely the way that it's done there, but let me just take 5 minutes to tell you how this would have gone if we'd done it the fancy way. Okay, so here are the two versions of the problem. So here's the one we're actually going to go into in detail. So given x1, m1, mu1, and x2, m2, mu2, we want a nice measure on x1 cross x2, and probably what, at very least, the first requirement of nice should be that the measure of a rectangle, so if E and F are both measurable sets in the two product factors, surely we should be able to ask that we can do this. And indeed, the answer is going to be yes, we can do this. And if x1 and x2 are sigma finite, there's a unique way to do this. Is everyone happy with what sigma finite means? Should I say that? Yeah? Okay, so sigma finite just means that x can be written as a union of countably many subsets xi. Usually you think of these as increasing subsets, so that the measure of each of the xi's is finite. Okay. So, for example, the real line is not a finite measure space, because the measure of the whole line is infinite, but it is a sigma finite measure space, because you could write R as this increasing union of the intervals from minus n to n. And each of those was finite measure. Okay. I mean, sigma anything nearly always means not quite that, but if you allow countable unions, then that. Okay, so that's the problem we're actually going to answer. And here's what we would have done if we persisted trying to be fancy. So given a radon integral from CCX1 to our radon, let's call that integral subscript 1, and another integral on the other space, 2, we want an integral on x1 cross x2. So that the integral of, if I have a compactly supported continuous function on x1 and a compactly supported continuous function on x2, I can easily make a compactly supported continuous function on x1 cross x2 just by taking the sort of exterior product of the two functions, by putting the two different arguments in the two different places. And what I could ask is that that's just the integral on the space 1 of f times the integral on the space 2 of g. Okay? And so this is meant to be sort of the analog from the integral's point of view of that condition for the measures function. And if you believe a little bit of theory, then that's actually very easy to do. So let me say this. So define CCX tensor CCY as the finite linear combos of functions f of x, g of y, with f a function on x, g a function on y, both continuous and both fundamentally simple. Okay, so that's, and this is certainly some subset of just all of the compactly supported continuous functions on x cross y. Okay, so Stern-Weierstrass theorem, which we'll actually get to shortly after the break, and if we were determined to do things the fancy way, we'd stop and prove right now. But, oh, not polynomial theorem. It says something useful about polynomials. The Stern-Weierstrass theorem says that this subspace here, CCX tensor CCY, is dense with respect to supernorm in all of these functions. Okay? So let's suppose x and y, sorry, I may have switched from, yeah, going from that board to this board, I switched from x1, x2 to x and y. Suppose x and y are compact, to make life easy for a moment. Okay? Then integral x and integral y, so in particular then x and y have finite measure, that is the integral of the constant one function is just some finite number, and that easily shows you that these are bounded linear functionals. Yeah, I mean, we always have this idea that like, when you integrate over some function over some set, that's bounded by the supernorm of f times the volume of a, okay? So if the volume is finite, then this is saying that integration is a functional with norm volume of a. So these guys are bounded linear functionals. And now can anyone see the amazing punchline? Well, what I can do is I can look at CCX tensor, sorry, not CCX, integral x tensor integral y, and that's a map from CCX tensor CCY to the reals, defined by take f of x, g of y, and send it to integrate f on x and integrate g on y. And it's pretty easy to see that that if both of these are separately bounded linear functionals, this guy is a bounded linear functional. But this is dense, so this is a bounded linear functional. A dense subspace of all of these guys. So, just like when we were doing back in Hilbert space theory or Fourier transform stuff, when we went from defining Fourier transforms on Schwarz functions to then saying there was a unique extension of that to all L2 functions because the Schwarz functions were dense, this says there's a unique extension to a bounded linear functional that takes us from here to R. And that then is our product Radon integral that we asked for over here. Of course, one needs to do a little bit of extra work then to get rid of this hypothesis, but it turns out one can. And it's not so bad, but I'm just not going to say anything about that. But okay, that was the what we would have done in more detail if we wanted to do the fancy version. So let's instead do the unfancy version. This, if anyone wants to see this, section 6.6 of analysis now. Does that in gory detail. Okay, so hurry up. Okay, so let's come back here, and I guess we've only got 2 minutes left. So let me not start talking about the measure that we'll define here, but just tell you what the sigma algebra is, because that's not so bad. So just the definition of mu 1 cross mu 2 is the sigma algebra generated by rectangles E cross F for E and M 1. There's not so much to say about that, except maybe I'll leave us with this exercise to think about. This is the coarsest sigma algebra, i.e. the sigma algebra with the least sets in it, so that from x1 and x2, I have these projection maps, pi1, pi2, that just pick out one factor, so that these are both measurable. I.e. that the inverse image of any measurable set here is measurable here. So that's nice to check that those are two equivalent ways of defining what the product sigma algebra is. And then next time, on Friday, we'll actually construct the same. Okay, see you all then. Any questions about this so far? Yeah.
When you were doing absolute continuity before, you forgot the absolute values on the sum, inside the sum.
Absolutely, yeah. It should have been F of, I forget what letters I used, BI minus F of AI. Yes, is less than. Anything else?